If we look at how health is distributed in populations and the causes of that distribution, by social determinants of health, we mean the conditions in which people are born, grow, live, work, and age. And the structural drivers of those conditions are inequities in power, money, and resources that determine inequities in the conditions of daily life. What we now know is that there is a really strong scientific base on what determines good child outcomes. And we think of good child outcomes as including physical development of children, education and cognitive development of children, social, emotional development, and the material condition, so all of those. And we need to look at each of those outcomes and see what's determining good outcomes. And the paper deals with the conditions of daily life and the structural drivers as they impact on those five outcomes. I'd say there are three major obstacles: lack of understanding, lack of care, and having other priorities. What we show very clearly is that it's not only children from poor families that have poor outcomes, but there's a social gradient. And by that I mean, if you classify parents by their income, by their education, the lower their position in the social hierarchy, the worse the outcomes for children. That's very different to most people's understanding. Children in the middle families have worse outcomes than those at the top, but better than those at the bottom, all the way from top to bottom. And that means we've got to deal not only with poverty, but with why we have these inequalities in outcomes. And people don't quite understand that that takes action across the whole of government, which is what we say very clearly in our paper. The second is lack of care. Some politicians just don't care. Bad governance, that's not their priority. They're not really concerned with the poor outcomes for today's children. They're concerned with doing other things. And the third is reasonable governance, but actually not putting in place the programs that are needed because they've got other priorities. They feel that economic problems because of the global financial crisis. Well, we can't afford to do it now. We'll do it when there's more money. And our argument is the financial crisis makes it even more important to do it right now, not waiting for the future. The science of early child development has leapt by leaps and bounds over the last two decades. What we now understand, firstly, the social gradient, that's not just poverty and poor outcomes. Secondly, we can build a picture from relative social disadvantage to the biology of stress to sculpting the brain, the impact of the biological correlates of stress on brain development and behavior of children. So we can go all the way from the structural drivers, the social determinants, chronic stress, biology, brain development to children's outcomes. That's new. Social scientists may have been concerned for decades about the well-being of children, but understanding the social gradient and understanding how the structural and social drivers get in under the skin to influence the brain and behavior, that's new science that's been developing over the last little while. The benefits of good early child development go right through the life course. You can see benefits very quickly in good early child development. You have children who have better readiness for school. So when they get into the school system, some children are readier to benefit from what the school has to give them, and some are less ready. That relates to early child development. So you can see that benefit really quickly. Then you can see how the children with better early child development perform better in school. They're more likely to get a good degree. They're more likely to get a good job and have higher income and have better health in adulthood. So we see these benefits right through the life course. When there's a global financial crisis and unemployment goes up, who are the people who are unemployed? They're the ones who didn't do so well in school, who in turn are the ones who didn't have good early child development. One of the things we've called for in our paper is the next phase of research, so that we can understand much better which countries have been doing good things and which haven't, and what we can learn from what countries have been doing and what they haven't been doing, so we can lay a much stronger evidence-based foundation for further action. So my answer to your question of good examples is rather preliminary, because we think that's the next stage of the research. But let me take one example. Cuba performs best among Latin American countries on measures of early child development, and going along with that, the better the performance among Latin American countries on early child development, the better the performance of later age school children on standard scores of literacy. So Cuba has the best scores on early child development and the best scores among later age children of literacy in school. They've put real effort into a universal system, not targeting the poor, but a universal system for all children. And we can see the benefits. Understanding what countries have been doing and what they haven't been doing is the next phase of the research. Finland consistently scores best on measures of school performance at age 15. And if you go back, Finland is in the top rank of countries on early child development. So you see, good scores in early child development relates to good scores in later age education. It's universal, it's for all children. It starts fairly early in life, long before children get into the school system, and continues throughout the school system. I think that's a very important lesson. The key message from our paper is, firstly, to recognize the social gradient in early child development. Secondly, to recognize that what happens in early childhood has profound impact right through the life course. And thirdly, to recognize that what the evidence shows is there's a great deal we can do right now.